Good morning. Welcome to the Converge Church online worship experience. We would like to extend a very warm welcome to all of you who've decided to make Converge Church a part of your weekly schedule. And to all of you who are joining us for the very first time, we want to extend an even warmer welcome to you. The decision you made to join us this week, this morning, is going to be a great one. I guarantee that. Even though we are unable to be together as we normally would, we want you to understand that God was not surprised by all of this that's happened, and that we are still prepared to move forward with worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ. We, the people, be the church, not a building, not a place to where we gather, but the church is all of us. So please join us as we go before the Lord and worship with Tim and Jamie.
Good morning, church. Let's pray. Father God, we're grateful for another day. Lord, though we can't be together, still we're going to praise you in our homes wherever we are. Father God, we're going to give you glory. God, because you're great, you are unchanging, even though our lives are not what we thought they'd be right now, God, and we can't be together. Lord, you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. So we worship you, we bless your name, we seek you, we set our eyes on you, and we long to glorify you this morning. Would you be pleased with our worship in Jesus' name? Amen.
Amen.
You give us so much joy, God. Thank you, Lord. I'll just begin to praise him and worship him for the joy he gives. Thank you, Lord. Let's sing. There's beauty in my brokenness. I've got true love instead of pain. There's freedom though you've captured me. And I've got joy instead of mourning. There's beauty. There's beauty in my brokenness. I've got true love instead of pain. There's freedom though you've captured me. I've got joy instead of mourning. You give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. You give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. There's beauty in my brokenness. I've got true love instead of pain. There's freedom though you've captured me. I've got joy instead of mourning. You give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. You give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. I've never been so free, caught in your love for me.
He loves me.
Never been more secure, knowing your heart,
He loves me.
Never been so free, caught in your love for me. Never been more secure, knowing your heart, Lord. Oh, joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. Yes, you give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. You give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. Yes, you give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. Oh, give him glory. Worship you, God. lift it up. You give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. You give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. Worship you, Lord. Lord, no one like you, Jesus. Thank you for the joy you give, oh God. Thank you for your love. Hallelujah. The world didn't give it, and the world can't take it away, church. Give him glory. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We bless your name, oh Lord. We bless your name. We bless your name. And thank you that you take us, these broken vessels, and you fill us with your Holy Spirit. You fill us with your very presence, oh God. And you use us. Thank you, Lord. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Thank you, Jesus.
All these pieces broken and scattered, in mercy gathered, mended and whole. Empty-handed, but not forsaken. I've been set free, I've been set free. Oh, amazing grace, how sweet.
Oh,
You didn't have to do it, but you did. You saved us.
Yeah.
You didn't have to do it, but you did. You didn't have to do it, but you did. You didn't have to do it, but you did. You saved us. You didn't have to do it, but you did. You didn't have to do it, but you did. You didn't have to do it, but you did. You saved us. You didn't have to do it, but you did. You didn't have to do it, but you did. You didn't have to do it, but you did. You saved us. You didn't have to do it, but you did. You didn't have to do it, but you did. You didn't have to do it, but you did. You saved us. You didn't have to do it, but you did. You didn't have to do it, but you did. You didn't have to do it, but you did. You saved us. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now
is your faithfulness toward us, oh God. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you, Jesus.
Great is thy faithfulness, oh God, my Father.
Morning by morning. thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see.
Always good to worship the Lord. You know, given this time where we're all at home, unable to congregate the way we normally do, unable to go to places that we normally go to, I want you to know that there are still ways that you can have access to build your Christian life. You don't have to stop. Right Now Media is a great resource that we provide that gives you so many Christian resources to access, and you can do it from anywhere you are, your iPad, your iPhone, your Android phone, your computer. All you have to do to get your account set up is contact our office at connect@myconvergechurch.com, and we'll get you in contact with those resources. The other thing I want you to be aware of is that the ministry doesn't stop just because we can't get together. The children's ministry is in full swing. As a matter of fact, at 7 p.m., there's a Zoom ministry starting on Wednesday. At 7:15 p.m., the kids actually check in on Instagram. There are also other ways to be involved. On Thursdays, the pastors will do a devotional at 12 p.m. and 7 p.m. on Facebook Live. So there's always something for you to do, always a way for you to maintain your connection. The mobile ministry, just a reminder, 1 p.m. today, you can hop in your car, drive through the parking lot, and wave socially distantly safe at your pastors and your leadership. Finally, right after the service today, we will be on Facebook Live. There's going to be a post-church live talk. So if you're on YouTube, switch over to Facebook Live. If you're on Facebook, stay on Facebook. And there's going to be a chat about the sermons. Now, if you would join me in welcoming Camille, she has a special message about Converge Church Women.
Greetings, ladies. I know you have a lot of questions. I know you want to know what's happening with our women's retreat for this year. Well, I have some good news, I have some bad news, and I have some even better news. So let's start with the bad news first. The bad news is we need to postpone our women's retreat until May 2021. Now, the good news is if you're already registered for this year, you're automatically registered for next year, and your deposit is already paid for our May 2021 retreat. Now, the even better news is that we are going to host a watch party on Saturday, May 16th. The watch party is going to go from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. And then at 2 p.m., when it's over, we're going to host a live Zoom call. So all the content that you would have gotten at the retreat, which is the Bible teaching by Priscilla Shire, which we love, and the praise and worship by her brother, Anthony Evans, you will have access to on that day. And then we're going to go ahead and we're going to be having our live Zoom call, so we'll be able to see your beautiful faces right afterwards. So we are looking forward to seeing you, looking forward to having you join us on Saturday, May 16th for Going Beyond 2020. See you then.
Good morning, Converge Church. Thank you for joining us online for our online worship experience. And also a special welcome to those that are watching us from wherever you are in the world. This is a unique time in the life of our nation. The whole world is basically on pause because of COVID-19. And we know that even with all the crisis, with all the challenges that we're facing, we're going to trust in the Lord, continue to trust in the Lord. Let's continue to practice our social distancing, washing your hands, making sure that you are mindful of those things around you. But also, just make sure that you're using this time to grow your faith, be connected with your family, because this, in my short life, this has never actually happened before. This is amazing. But I believe that God can do some of his greatest work in our most difficult times of challenge and our difficult times of crisis. So I don't want you to be fearful. I want you to be prepared. You know, we may not go back to life as normal. Church may not be church as normal. But I tell you what, when the world changes, when even how we gather changes, there is one person who remains the same. God never changes. So I want to welcome you to our broadcast. A little housekeeping here. I want you to, as we begin to hear this word, I want you to make your house, your apartment, wherever you are, make this your sanctuary. You're going to meet God today. I want you to prepare a place, not only physically, but also a place in your heart to receive the word of God. And finally, Pastor George and myself, the entire elder team here at Converge Church, we are praying for you and we are with you at this time. So I want you to turn with me to the book of Genesis. Turn with me to the book of Genesis. It's the first book of the Bible, Genesis, the very first book. Genesis actually means beginning. So turn to the beginning. And we're going to talk to you from a message, hopefully, that I believe will impact your heart. So let's look at Genesis chapter 16. And I want to preach from a message entitled, The God Who Sees Me. The God Who Sees Me. So let's hear the first verse, Genesis chapter 16, verse 13 says, Thereafter, Hagar used another name to refer to the Lord who had spoken to her. She said, You are the God who sees me. She also said, Have I truly seen the one who sees me? Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this word. I thank you for this time. I pray, God, that you would get all the glory out of our lives. God, we live for you. Our life is hidden in you. And even the things that we're concerned about, we can bring them to you because you give us a guarantee in your word that you see us. Lord, have your way. Speak to us, I pray. Hide me behind the cross so that they can hear you in Jesus' name. Amen. When I think about one of my favorite hobbies, it is watching movies. And I loved this movie when it came out, The Incredibles. Y'all remember that movie, The Incredibles? The Incredibles was a movie about a family who the mother and father were superheroes, but because of all the damage that was caused and the bad will that was created because not catching all the criminals or even the political system turning against them, they actually had to retire from being superheroes. But this family longed to, specifically the father, he longed for the glory days. This family was called the Parr family. So in the Parr family, you had the father who was trying to be all that he used to be, Bob Parr. And then you had the wife. She was her ability was to be stretchy. So she was stretching, going here, going there. That was her thing with Elastigirl. That was her name. And so her ability was to be stretched. And then there was a daughter. Her name was Violet. Violet had the ability to create these elaborate and really strong force fields. Then there was Dash. Dash was a little boy, and he was just running around. He had supersonic speed. No one could catch him. And then Baby Jack-Jack. Baby Jack-Jack was, they didn't know what he was. He was developing into who he was supposed to be. He had all these different types of abilities, and they found those out later on. And so here you have this family, like you and me, the father trying to relive the glory days, the mother stretched to no end, the daughters putting up force fields around them, the son can't stay in one place, and then a little baby that seems to be running things. One of the abilities I didn't mention about Violet was that she had the ability to be invisible. She had this ability where she could just make herself disappear. In my family, we talk about having different superheroes or having different superhuman abilities. And so one of the ones we always talk about is having super strength or being able to be the fastest or the strongest. But I tell you, that invisible ability, that's a pretty powerful one. You know, it's pretty powerful when you choose to be invisible. But it's not so powerful when you have no ability to be seen. And that's how some of us are. In life, everybody else seems to be high priority, but you seem to be invisible. You appear that no one sees you. No one cares about you. Through this message, I want you to know that God sees you. God hears you. God knows what you're going through. And God's got a plan for you too. So let's jump into the text here. The text starts out with God being revealed, and we get the name through Hagar, a new name of God, and that name is El Roi. And that name means the God who sees me. So Hagar, we're going to jump into her story. Hagar has a tremendous story where all throughout her life she hasn't been seen, but there is a God who is seeing her. God is going to show up in her life. So this is your word for today, El Roi. It's a new name for God, or one of the names of God. It means the God who sees me. And I love it. It's not just the God who sees, but it's the God who sees me. God wanted me to tell you that you're not invisible. He sees you. I don't care if you've been laid off from your job. Maybe you still have to work double shift. Maybe your job is in jeopardy and you don't know what's going to happen. I'm telling you, God sees you, God knows you, and God is with you. So in this story, we're going to hear about Abram. We're going to hear about Sarai, whose name means princess. Abram means father of many nations. And it's so interesting. Abram has no kids at this point, but God gave him the name father of many nations. It's almost like God is playing a trick on him, playing with him. Sarai means my princess. Hagar, her name means flight. The baby that she's going to give birth to, his name is Ishmael. And Ishmael, his name means God listens. So let's just jump into this story here. Genesis chapter 16, verse 1. It says, now Sarai, Abram's wife, had borne him no children. She was unable, or she had not been able to bear children for him, but she had an Egyptian servant named Hagar. So in ancient Egyptian time, it was quite possible and legal, actually, when you were able to take people in your possession and you owned them. Remember in Genesis chapter 12, God had already told Abram, I want you to leave your family, leave your place of origin, and I want you to take a 3-day trip, and I'm going to take you to a land where I'm going to show you. So Abram takes everything, takes his family, no doubt takes Hagar, and he goes to the land where God is showing him. And when he gets there, he's going to the Canaan land. So he, all these possessions that he had, but he didn't have a son. So in this journey, while he's in Canaan, he realizes, or the story picks up, that Sarai is barren, but she had a servant named Hagar. So knowing the plan, God had already told Abram, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to make your nation great. I'm going to make you a blessing. And Sarai, she heard that. She knew that. So what did she do? Knowing that she couldn't bear children for her husband, she devised a plan. And the plan was that she was going to give Hagar to Abram so that through Hagar, she could have this. She could help build a house. I mean, that's really what she was trying to do. She was trying to build a house for Abram. She was trying to build a house to fortify what God had said. It reminds me of Psalm 127. It says, unless the Lord builds a house, they labor in vain who build it. See, here, Sarai wanted to step in and help God. So what did she do? So in Genesis 4 and 5, she said, so Abram had sexual relations. Matter of fact, Sarai had suggested it. She said, sleep with my servant. So Abram had sexual relations with Hagar, and she became pregnant. But when Hagar knew she was pregnant, she began to treat her mistress, Sarai, with contempt. That contempt. Boy, I tell you, it's been said that two women can't share a kitchen. It's very difficult. And I know that two women can't share a man. I know polygamy was allowed in the Old Testament, but it never worked out right because there was always animosity and hatred among the women. But God used this scenario to show us that his way is the best. So he got Hagar pregnant, and the Bible says as soon as Hagar started to realize that she could have a child, her belly started showing, the Bible says she despised her mistress. It got so heated in that family that God had to sort of, Abram was supposed to step in, but his hands were tied. Sarai is the one who suggested that he sleep with Hagar. And then out of this, now she eventually says to Abram, this is all your fault. I put my servant into your arms, but now that she's pregnant, she treats me with contempt. And the Lord will show who's wrong, you or me. Here's the interesting point that you can't miss. They never asked Hagar her opinion. She was property. She was expendable. She was invisible. During this whole process, she never asked to be in this predicament. She never asked to be in this situation. Now, granted, she probably didn't do the best thing. She shouldn't have shown contempt for her boss. That probably wasn't the wisest thing to do. But she didn't ask for it. And as a result of this, now tension is in the family. But she, the Bible says, she despised her mistress. Despise means she made small. She made light of her mistress. And Sarai picked up on that thing quick. And she's like, oh, we can't have this. And she even said, Hagar despises me in her eyes. So Sarai was the one who was acted upon with this sense of animosity. Hagar did it. So now there's tension in the house, and Sarai goes to Abram and said, look, you got to do something. This is your fault. And so Abram says what any husband will do. Okay, well, you handle it. Whatever you decide is what's going to happen. While all this is going on, Hagar feels the heat. She knows she's in a hostile work environment. Plus, she's pregnant, so she doesn't know what to do. So her first instinct is to flee. That's what her name means. Hagar means flight. It means to get out of Dodge. That's usually what happens when you and I face a heated situation. There's two instincts that either kick in. You got to fight or you got to flight. You either stand there and take it or you say, I'm out of here. See, sometimes when we're put in a heated situation, that really shows us what we're all about. Maybe many of you, like me, all of us, are in a situation where you don't have control. You wish you could go back to work. You wish you could, you know, resume your normal activities, but you can't. So instead of us, you know, retreating and just becoming reclusive and just staying in our homes, no, there are some things that we can do. We can prepare while we're still in this age of social distancing. We can still grow, still develop, still increase our faith. You can still do a lot. So she runs. And I love this. As she's running, the angel of the Lord meets her and says to her, Hagar, Sarah's servant, where have you come from and where are you going? Man, he's like, what's going on? Now, here's the thing. This angel of the Lord knows where she came from and where she's going. Matter of fact, that's why he said Sarai's servant. The Lord already knows. One thing I love about God is God doesn't get information. He's knowledge. God doesn't learn anything. You and I have to learn something. But God knows. And God is very concerned. So the Bible says the angel of the Lord said to her, Hagar, where have you come from and where are you going? She said, I'm running from my mistress Sarai, she replied. And here's what the angel of the Lord told her. In verse number 9, the angel told her, go back to your mistress and submit to her. What? Yep, go back and submit. And the angel added, I will increase your descendants that they will be too numerous to count. So God had already told Sarai, listen. Well, he didn't tell Sarai, he told Hagar, listen, I know your situation. Go back. Why does she need to go back? Because there were some things that God was going to set in motion. There's some things that needed to be experienced. I mean, think about it. Doesn't say it in the text. But before Isaac came on the scene, at least Ishmael had a father. At least he could see Ishmael every day. Ishmael and Abram had a relationship. They saw each other. And Abram, he actually loved Ishmael. But the only problem was, this was not the promised child. See, whenever you and I start to get involved with God's plans, we always make a mess of it. And Sarai, she thought she could get ahead of God, but that wasn't God's plan. God said, I know what I'm doing, and I don't need your help. So maybe for us, maybe this time of isolation, it's really a challenge for us because we're so used to making things happen. We're so used to doing it and getting things going, but God is saying, nope, I'm shutting it all down. You got to trust in me. You got to trust that I'm in complete control. So she goes back and she says the angel says to Sarai or to Hagar, I said, listen, let me tell you a little bit about your son. Here's what's going to happen. He said, this son of yours will be a wild man, untamed as a wild donkey. He will raise his fist against everyone. This guy's going to be a troublemaker. And everyone will be against him. And they're going to hate him. They said all this stuff. He said, yes, he will live in open hostility against all his relatives. Well, rightly so. He grew up in an environment like this. It's a challenge. I'd be stressed out too. I mean, you're in a situation where your mother's boss don't like you. Your dad, he's trying to show love, but he can't show too much love because it'll make his wife mad. And then your mother, who's caught in the middle, had no voice. You may feel like, man, I'm caught in the middle too. I'm caught in the middle of something I didn't even create. I didn't ask to be born into this family. I didn't ask to be laid off of my job. I didn't ask to have this sickness or this disease. Listen, sometimes you find yourself in a situation that was not of your doing. It could have been somebody else's doing as a result of someone else's sin. You may be in the situation that you're in. But I want you to know that God sees you. He's always seen you. So as Hagar receives this message about her son, she's like, I guess she's comforted. So she decides, okay, Lord, I see you. Here's what she says in verse 13. Therefore, or thereafter, Hagar used another name to refer to the Lord. So we know that this angel of the Lord could have been a theophany. It could have been a vision or a representation of God. Because she says, now I've seen the one who sees me. I have seen the one who has seen me. And she says to God, she names him. She said, you are the God who sees me. You literally see me. Yes, Hagar up until that point, she'd been invisible, not asked to be put in this situation, didn't ask to be captured as a slave, didn't ask to be put on this assignment to be the surrogate father or the surrogate mother for this promised seed or promised child who actually turned out to be a son of our human doing. She didn't ask for any of that. But God says, even though you didn't ask for any of that, I see you. And she names him. She literally names him. This Egyptian woman names him. She also said, "Have I truly seen the one who sees me?" Yes, she has. She's seen the Lord. So, whatever you're facing, whatever you're dealing with, I want you to know that God sees you. God's always seen you. You're not invisible to God. God, his eyes are everywhere. In Psalm 121, verse 3, the Bible says, "The Lord watches over you. The Lord is who watches over Israel." God sees you. In Joshua chapter 2, God saw Rahab as she was protecting the spies. She was the harlot, and no one suggested or no one suspected anything different to see these strange men in her house. But even with that, God was saying to her, "Yep, although you were hiding in plain sight, I see you." God also said to the woman, the widow at Zarephath in 1 Kings 17, "I see you. I'm concerned about you. I got your back." God has always seen us. His eyes are always upon you. The Bible says that God watches over you with singing. God is concerned about you, and God watches you. In Psalm 121, further it goes, verse 3 and 4, "He will not let you stumble. The one who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel never slumbers or sleeps." Maybe during this time you're so panicked, you feel overlooked, left out. And you feel like, I'm so anxiety ridden. And some of you may have problems sleeping. But the Bible tells us here in Psalm 121, the Lord never slumbers or sleeps. So if you and I are resting in him, we can rest. The Bible says he gives his beloved sweet sleep. So tonight, next week, whenever you hear this message, trust that the Lord is in control. You can rest in him. You don't have to stay up all night. There's no need for you and him being up. So you go ahead and go to sleep. God says, "I got this." In John chapter 1, verse 48, you have this encounter with Nathanael. Philip has told Nathanael, "Nathanael, listen, we found the Messiah." Nathanael said, "Well, where'd he come from?" And Philip said, "We came from Nazareth." And Nathanael says, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Well, can anything good come out of that town? It's almost like saying, can anything good come out of Camden? Can anything good come out of Patterson? Can anything good come out of Elon, North Carolina, where I'm from? Yes. God doesn't look at your beginning to determine your end. God can do whatever he wants to do. But Nathanael, God saw him. Matter of fact, he says, when he meets Nathanael, Nathanael said, "How did you know about me? How'd you know about me?" And Jesus said, "I could see you under the fig tree before Philip found you." Nathanael was like, "All right, you must be a great teacher. You must be a rabbi. You must be the who Philip says you are." God sees you just like he saw all of them. The next thing is God knows what you're facing. Hagar was invisible to Abraham and to Sarah. And at that time, it was Abram and Sarai. She was still invisible to them. Legally, she was property and had no rights. Hagar, in this situation, being invisible, it's very possible that sometimes through this sense of not being heard, you want to do things to be heard. You want to start, you know, maybe passive aggressive or doing something, being the rowdy one just to get attention. Some people are just, you know, raise all kind of ruckus just because some attention is better than none at all. And so God said, "No, I know what you're facing. Hagar and Sarai are the exact opposite. Sarai is old, barren, she's married, and she's free. Hagar is young, fertile. She's not married, but she's in bondage. It's like they're the exact opposites. And that opposition hit every time. It was actually interesting because the seed of these two women would be fighting. That's why we have these conflicts in the Middle East now. Two brothers fighting over the love of their father. That's what the big deal is about. Here's one thing that's interesting too. During all this stuff that Hagar was asked to do, they never even asked her. They didn't ask Hagar if she wanted to be a part of all this. Nope, it just happened. You may feel like, I didn't ask to be a part of this. I didn't ask to be involved in this. God says, I know, I got you. The other thing is that God hears your cry. So let's fast forward. So Hagar comes back. Her and Ishmael are born, or Ishmael's born. And then 10 years after being in Canaan, God gives Abram and Sarai the great news. You are pregnant. Sarai can't believe it. At first, she laughed when the angels visited her several years earlier and told her she was going to be with child. She laughed when she was confronted. She said, no, I didn't laugh. But it's interesting. Isaac's name means God has made me laugh. So in her old age, she was 90. Abram's 100. They have this bouncing baby boy. And so for these 13 to 15 years, the baby Isaac grows up with Ishmael. And Sarai's still watching. She still got her eye on Hagar because she doesn't forget about the time that she gave Hagar into the hands of her husband. She ain't forget about that. Women don't forget. And so while they're growing up, there's this animosity one toward another. And finally, Sarah, whose name is Sarah at this time, she says to Abraham, she's got to go. You got to get this woman out of my family. She's got to go. And so one of the hardest things that Abraham had to do was to tell his son goodbye. You know, we look at this in scripture and we think, oh, he just sent her on. But no, it says, look at verse 14 of Genesis 21. Early the next morning, Abraham took some food and a skin of water and gave them to Hagar. He set them on his shoulders. He set them on her shoulders and then sent her off with the boy. She went on her way and wandered in the desert of Beersheba. Abraham probably wasn't looking forward to that day where he had to tell one of his sons, you got to go. He got up personally and prepared a to-go package for them. So as the child's going into the desert, verse 15, when the water in the skin was gone, she put the boy under one of the bushes. Then she went off and sat down nearby about a bow's throw away, for she thought, I cannot watch the boy die. So the boy, Ishmael, is now dying of thirst. She is so distraught, she can't even be near him. He's over under a bush. She's crying. She said, I got to get away. I don't want to hear his crying. It's just breaking my heart. But then the Bible says in verse 17, God hears the boy crying. See, God hears your cry. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy is coming in the morning. Why? Because God is not only seeing, but he's listening. God hears. And so God comes to this woman. The angel appears to Hagar from heaven and said to her, what is the matter, Hagar? As if God didn't already know. He knew. He's always been watching. He's always known. You may say, God, nobody understands. God said, I definitely understand. Matter of fact, Jesus in Hebrews is the high priest who can be equated with our suffering. Jesus is the only high priest who's qualified to be our Savior. Why? Because he knows what it's like. He knows the things that you and I go through. He says, do not be afraid. God has heard the boy crying as he lies there. Lift the boy up. Take him by the hand, for I will make him into a great nation. She picks him up and she takes him, and then she sees this oasis. She sees water. She sees a well. And when she went and filled the skin with water and gave it to the boy to drink, then the boy came back. He got his strength back. See, God always sees us. God always hears us. And God always knows. You know, when God asks a question, he says, hey, God, what's wrong? He already knew. God already knows. But it's good for him. It's good for us to tell him what's going on. He may know, but he wants to hear from you and me. That's what prayer is. So as the boy cries, God hears. And then God tells him this thing. Let me remind you of what I said to you about your son. He's going to be a man who's going to be great. Verse 20 says, God was with the boy as he grew up. He lived in the desert and became an archer. While he was living in the desert of Paran, his mother got a wife for him from Egypt. So God knew that he had a future for him. His future was going to be great. Why? Because God was with him. So God sees you. God hears you. God knows what you're going through. And God's got a plan for you too. Even in the midst of this challenge we're facing, God is with us. In Genesis 21:19, he says, I will make a great nation of his descendants. The same thing that God said to Abram in Genesis 12. God's going to keep his promise. God keeps his word. What you and I have to do is, our job is to sort of get out of God's way and let God do it. That's the work of a believer. Following Christ, having faith, and then getting out of the way so God can do his work. Because we've got a God who sees us, sees you and me. You may say, Pastor Jonathan, I felt like I was invisible. I felt like God wasn't seeing me. I felt like there's no one to help me. And I want to just give you this assurance. God says, I've always seen. I've always heard. I've always known. The Bible says that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Christ made the first move for you and me before you and I were even thinking about it. So you may be feeling today like maybe you're in your apartment all by yourself. Maybe you're in your home full of people, but you still feel invisible. You still feel like nobody sees me. Well, God says to you today, I am El Roi. I am the God who sees you. God sees you, and you know God sees you, then I want to encourage you to get to know this God, just like Hagar got to know this God. The only way for you and I to know God, the God who sees us, is to have a personal relationship with Jesus. And you do that by saying, Christ, come into my heart. Be my Lord and Savior. You know, all throughout this story, God has been with Hagar. Just as he was with Hagar, he's with you. Jesus said, I've never left. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I'll be with you. And so maybe today will be the day that you say, I want to see the one who sees me. I want to make Jesus the Lord and Savior of my life. Simply just ask Christ to come into your heart. This prayer I prayed it a number of times. And this prayer is simply this. Say, dear Jesus, come into my heart. Be my Lord and Savior. I turn away from this world and I embrace you. You know that simple prayer, they call it the sinner's prayer. That prayer, there's no magical powers in the prayer. You know where the magic happens is when you decide to give your heart over to the Lord. The greatest miracle on earth is not seeing someone raised from the dead, but the greatest miracle on earth is seeing a heart that was a heart of stone being turned into a heart of flesh. And that's what God wants to do in your life today. So let's pray. Father, I thank you for this time. I thank you for those that are making a decision for you. This is the greatest time ever in our life. It's a challenge. It's a tragedy for many families, but it's still a great time. Why? Because you are with us, even in the heartache, even in the despair. God, I thank you that you see us. and let your people know that you're always there. We bless you. We honor you. We praise you. In Jesus' name, God bless you.
Thank you, Pastor Jonathan, for another impactful message. We have something special for you today. One of our missionaries, Trey Foster from InterVarsity Fellowship, campus ministry that seeks to raise up disciples of Jesus Christ on colleges and universities throughout the nation and actually the world, is with us today via video. And you're going to see a short video just in a moment that'll kind of profile his ministry, and then we're going to have an opportunity to give to that ministry.
Hello, Converge Church. I'm Trey Foster, college campus missionary with InterVarsity, ministering on campuses at Roman College, Brown County, Roman College, South Jersey, Rutgers, Camden, and Camden County College. And I want to thank you for your faithful prayers and your financial support. Your support is important in reaching college-age young adults in our South Jersey region. And I want to share with you what God has been doing lately on campus. So far, 2020, we have seen 13 conversions on campus. This past February, we have seen 6 decisions of faith in our weekly Bible study at Rowan College in South Jersey. And then this past fall semester, we have seen 7 decisions of faith at Rowan College, Brown County. In the past year and a half, we have seen 68 new believers and 120 students actively extending gospel invitations on campus, and over 40 student leaders who are involved in our chapters that are leading the ministries on campus. And I will not be able to do the work God has called me to do without your faithful partnership in the gospel, through your prayers and your financial support. I just want to thank you for your partnership. And I have 2 main prayer requests. Continue to pray for creativity and reaching students with the gospel via online. We're using Zoom as a way for our online Bible studies. So pray for the next couple of weeks as we make gospel invitations, and pray that students would come to know you and come to faith in Jesus. And also prayers for financial support. I need to raise $16,000 before June 30th. And I just want to thank Converge Church for your faithful partnership and your finance. Lives are being transformed because of your investment in the kingdom. And I want to give an invitation on behalf of the congregation of Converge Church to prayerfully consider giving a one-time gift or joining my monthly support team. If you are interested, partner with me financially. You can email me at trey.foster@innervarsity.org, or you could reach me through text or call 609-498-8523. So my email is, again, trey.foster@intervarsity.org. Or you can reach me by cell, 609-498-8523. And I just want to say again, thank you for your faithful partnership in the gospel. And without your partnership in the gospel, I won't be able to do the work God has called me to do on campus. God bless.
We now have an opportunity to give. We actually have 2 opportunities to give. One opportunity to give to Trey Foster, InterVarsity Christian Fellowship. As I noted earlier, as you saw in the video, it is a campus ministry. It's devoted to making disciples of Jesus Christ. You can give the conventional way that we give. You can give through PushPay. You can give through the church app. You can go to myconvergechurch.com online and give. You can stop by the church and give, and you can mail it in to us. If you give on the church app or on our website, or just push pay in general, there's a drop-down box, just mark missions. We're also going to have a second opportunity to give. That's just our general collection. I think it's important to note at this point, if you're new to Converge, you haven't been a part of our church family, please don't at all feel compelled to give. For all the rest of your church family, we want to continue to give and give faithfully. And I thank you for your faithful giving. And you can continue to give the same way we give to the missionary, through the church app, through the website, through the mail, through PushPay. Please give, just designate it tithes and offerings. We'd appreciate that very, very much. Let's now bring our time together to a close as we pray for the offerings and just pray for you. Father, we come in Jesus' name, and we're very, very grateful for how good you are to us. You're always good, and you're always gracious. Even though there's some tough things and some bad things that are going on, Lord, you're good. And in the midst of it all, you preserve us, and you provide for us. Thank you for all the resources that you've given us, even in this time where things have been squeezed. And Lord, I pray that you would help us to give and to give generously, to be able to support Trey, to continue to sow into the kingdom of God. Lord, I appreciate each one that's giving, and I appreciate those that are unable to give, that just are tuning in with us or for us, Lord, to hear what you're doing. Lord, I pray that your favor, your blessing might rest upon us. We might continue to advance your kingdom and your strength and your power. And I ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. So the Lord bless you, keep you, and give you his peace. Amen.